Well, thank you all for being here today. I want to acknowledge first my colleague, Councilman Trevino, who has been a tremendous supporter in creating compassionate policies in San Antonio. We talked about his night overnight in the courtyard about a month ago, and it's very enlightening to be in and among the people who work in your area. So thanks so much for your work. San Antonio is a charitable city. We've seen that on a large scale. People like to know our city from what happened in 2005 under Mayor Phil Harberger, when the world was trying to figure out up from down after the Hurricane Katrina, and Mayor Harberger opened our arms and said, come here. We will take you in, we will be neighbors, we will be friends, and we will be with you in your darkest times. We've seen that recently in our city's response from organizations such as the Chambers of Commerce to our international offices on the response to Typhoon Haiyan in the Philippines and the outpouring of support that this community gave to that those communities in the Philippines. And we've seen it on a small scale every day, the daily acts of kindness that people in this room undertake to make our community a better place for those individuals who most need it. Nowhere in this is the spirit of San Antonio's generosity more evident than our desire to feed our homeless neighbors. The goal of today's summit is to empower those who feel called to give and to make sure they do so safely and responsibly. I'm the chair of the city's Quality of Life Committee. I've worked with my council colleagues, such as Councilman Trevino, and city staff to examine the policies that govern the feeding of homeless in San Antonio and to ensure that they protect the health of those being fed without hindering those doing the feeding. I want to make special recognition to Melody Woolsey and the Department of Human Services, the outstanding work they do for the city every day. Certainly there are policies, and we can all point to them in any number of areas in our community that need to be refined. We began this discussion a few months ago at the council committee level because we identified this as being one of those areas we've been talking about as a community. Let's refine it. Let's work with our stakeholders. If we want to move the city forward, we have a genuine interest in doing so. We'll work together to make it happen. We agreed that this was an important first step coming to you, the foot soldiers in this fight, for your input and guidance. So I want to thank you all. Each one of you sitting here today has input on this issue. You're all stakeholders in attendance. Certainly, again, thank you for being here, to city staff, for organizing this summit, and most importantly, those of you who dedicate your time and talent serving San Antonians in need, this day is for you. We are a city of compassion, we are a city of charity and hope, and today's discussion will only bear that out. There's a lot of work yet to do ahead, and we thank you for your patience as we begin to really work on how we refine our policy and move forward together as a city under those values. So thank you very much for being here. I look forward to having the discussions with you. Turn it back over.
Thank you, Councilman, for kicking us off. So a few orders of business. Let's take a look at this agenda real quick. In a moment, I'm gonna ask Melody Woolsey to come up and walk you through just a handful of slides to put the issue in context. And then let me introduce Lady Romano. Lady and I work at United Way. We're delighted to be here today as your facilitators. And after the presentation, we're gonna walk you through a series of questions, and we're gonna try and have a focused conversation on some high point questions. That we're gonna do that for about 2 hours, okay? We're not gonna take any formal potty breaks. The restrooms are right outside these doors to the left. There's some water in the back of the room if you require it, okay? Let's see. What I'd like to do is go around the room very quickly and have you introduce yourself and the organization that you represent, okay? Your name and the organization that you represent. The quicker we do this, the more time you're gonna have to talk at the back end of this, okay? So let's start at this table right here.
Jennifer Noriega with San Antonio Food Bank.
Ron Brown, neighbor for Old Chuck Garbage.
Tracy Boulon, Hemisphere.
Jeff Baldwin, Hemisphere.
Megan Jansen, San Antonio Food Bank.
Diane Trujillo, Christian Assistance Ministry.
Janet Adams, and Stephen Christopher Church.
Diane Hubbard, Church Under the Bridge.
Andy Wright, Church Under the Bridge.
Roberto Trevino, Councilman, District 1.
Melanie Boozley, City of San Antonio.
Anthony Trevino, Chief of Police.
Laura Houston, City Manager of Office.
Patty Labonte, Central San Antonio.
Vince Nathan, Manager of Health.
Xavier Rica, City Manager's Office.
Ron Aaronberg, City Council, District 8.
Louis Williams, Corazon Ministries.
Bonnie Marshall, Travis Park, United Methodist Church.
Steve Barshewski, San Antonio Metropolitan Health District.
Ed Muslan, City of San Antonio.
Shreya Shah, City of San Antonio.
Edward Gonzalez, Human Services Department.
David Lodge, Corazon Ministries.
Brian Allison, Porterville Ministries, plus Travis Park, United Methodist Church.
Well, look, I am from the Police Department.
Seth Cam, I do drawings and paintings of the homeless about the West Story.
Hi, my name is Kelly, and I'm here from Councilman Warwick's office, the East Side of District 2.
Hi, I'm Mike Russell with Taking of the Streets Ministry.
Bill Hunter, South Alamo Regional Alliance for the Homeless.
I'm Paul Dean with God's Guardian Angels.
Amy Dash, do you remember God's Guardian Angels?
Frank Kielbasa, Society of St. Vincent Paul.
Brooke House, Taking Into the Streets Ministry. Bonnie Crawl, Metro Church of Resurrection.
Mark Johnson, Taking Into the Streets Ministries.
John Clamp, Hotel Lodging Association.
Jane George with Grace Episcopal Church.
Nancy Hunt with the Paseo del Rio Association.
Michael Wallace with the San Antonio Tourism Council.
Melissa Payne, First Presbyterian Church.
Justin Holly, President of Visitors Commission.
Alan Ott with Latin of the Bridge, Inc.
Dennis Quinn with the Chaffron.
Joe Cheever with the Chaffron.
Bill Holland with Under the Bridge, Inc.
Pam Hall with Under the Bridge, Inc. Christina Abbott with Under the Bridge Ministries.
Paul Smith with Under the Bridge Ministries. Martin Wicks, Resurrection Ministries. Jim Spicker, Professor of Sociology, specializing in the study of homelessness.
Peter Fernandez, Catholic Charities.
Lulav Somali, Catholic Charities.
Gladys Gonzalez, Catholic Charities, Wallaville Community Center.
Fran Cleary, United Way.
Chris Pleshay, Catholic Worker House.
Karen Dahl, Mobile Arts and Fishes, St. Mark's Catholic Church.
Christy Flores, Mobile Arts and Fishes, St. Mark's Catholic Church.
You need it?
Yeah.
Jed Mabius, City Council, District 1.
I'm not ignoring the media. I just don't feel like you need to introduce yourself.
Ramiro Salazar, Library Department.
Dale McNeil, Library Department.
Bruce Diego, Library Department. Nancy Williams, Bureau of County Community Resources.
Scott Ackerson, Haven for Hope and the Center for Healthcare Services.
Jessica Dolina, City of San Antonio.
Leah Vargas, St. Francisco Paul.
Jimmy Richards, Central San Antonio.
Raymond Castro, Park Police.
Brian Wooden, Parks and Recreation.
Philip Covington, Parks and Recreation.
Andrew Sassman, United Way.
Accra.
Javier Salazar, San Antonio Police.
Jennifer Marys, Office of the City Manager.
Jeff Coyle, City of San Antonio. Jim Mary, Finish City Development and Operations.
Richard Keith, the City's Department of Human Services.
Deirdre Murphy, Department of Human Services.
Okay, the shy people in the back. I'd like to say thanks to Ramiro for hosting us in your beautiful library, and thank you for all the Trevino beautiful artwork that's here today. It's really awesome, so thanks. Okay, now I'm going to introduce Melanie Boozley, who is the head of the Department of Human, the Director of the Department of Human Services for the City of San Antonio.
So good afternoon. You know, this is a great turnout, and I, on behalf of the City of San Antonio, I really appreciate you, all of you being here and showing up and participating in this event, in this conversation. So the city has a long history of commitment to addressing homelessness in San Antonio. As Tony said, I do direct the Departments of Human Services for the City of San Antonio, and that includes coordination of homeless initiatives that the city is involved in, as well as management of the homeless investments that the city makes. And so before we get started with our discussion, I want to provide, that Tony will facilitate, I do want to provide some background and an overview of the issue that we're here to talk about and our review of homeless feeding policy, as well as the goals for today's summit. And so as background, in April and May, the City Council Quality of Life Committee requested that staff provide a briefing on the current policies that regulate feeding of the homeless and compassionate feeding, and also to conduct research on practices and in around the country and in comparable cities to San Antonio. Quality of Life staff, council members recommended that staff develop policy options and recommendations that will support the compassionate efforts of charitable organizations and individuals, as well as protect the health and welfare of the community and the homeless. Based on our review of best practices and the input that we received today from you, we will plan to present policy options and recommendations to City Council in the fall. And so the purpose of today's summit, I think it's important to start out and give you a framework of what we're doing here today. And we want, the most important thing is that we want to get your input on this issue. We're asking for your help to identify the barriers and challenges to feeding the homeless and those that are in crisis or are vulnerable. But even more importantly, we want to get your ideas and your solutions and your and some of your ideas about the opportunities for feeding the homeless in the community. Additionally, we really want this summit to start the conversation. This isn't a one-time thing. We want to have ongoing conversations with you, the city does, but we also want you to have ongoing conversations between yourselves, a way to coordinate services and ensure that the homeless are being served in a safe manner. And so you've heard us say many times over the last few months that the city does not have a law or a regulation regarding homeless feeding or that prohibits homeless feeding. The city code starts with and follows state law. That's first and foremost. And it's state law for food safety. And then it also includes mobile vending and food establishments and distribution of food. These regulations apply to food that is sold or given out. And it also regulates distribution of food for all organizations, as well as charitable organizations. The distribution of food on private property without the permission of property owners may also be subject to trespassing laws. And I know everyone here believes that food safety is important. I don't think there's any doubt about that. One of the handouts at your table does talk about the things that any group can do. What is legal, what permits are available, what processes are open to the community to provide food in a charitable way. And so now, with your input, we want to identify more opportunities for serving the homeless. And so that's really the goal of today. And so in reviewing policy options, our primary focus is to ensure the safety and welfare of the community while encouraging and facilitating charitable acts. Ensuring food safety is particularly important with vulnerable populations who may be subject to more impact from bad food. They have less opportunities to seek medical attention. It's important that we protect that. We're also concerned with protecting property and the environment, whether it's public or private property. We want it to be left clean and safe. And to be frank, this is the challenge of homeless feeding that we get the most complaints about. And the mess that's left when food packaging is thrown on the ground or when bathrooms are not available. And we know that this is not happening with every organization, but it's something that would need to be addressed in any policy that we either review or develop. And finally, connecting the homeless to other services. That's the other thing that's very important to the city. We can provide food today, and that's important, but we want to make sure that people have the opportunity to connect to services that help them provide food for the rest of their lives. And so how can we facilitate ongoing coordination and provide opportunities for coordination? One way is through the community's homeless continuum of care, the South Alamo Alliance for the Homeless, also known as SARA. So SARA is a network of providers and stakeholders in the community. It already exists. They are always looking for new organizations to provide insight and feedback on what's going on with the homeless. There are a lot of unique, there are multiple needs, and there's not one agency that can serve them all. And so Sarah really provides a network of those agencies, and we would encourage any of you to participate in that network. We have a membership from Sarah here, the executive director, Billy Hubbard. And so hopefully through today's conversation, you can get to know about that organization. And finally, you know, the human toll of being chronically homeless is high, and it's also avoidable. We spend a lot of resources on emergency care for the homeless, medical, health care, justice system, social services, and we think it's important to try to avoid that. And that is really the reason for the city's significant investment in homelessness. In total, the city's annual budget includes $9.3 million for homeless services. The majority of that, yes, is at Haven for Hope, but a lot of that goes to community organizations such as SAM Ministries, St. Vincent de Paul, St. PJ's, organizations that are providing homeless prevention, rapid rehousing, and shelter services, as well as mental health services. It's a comprehensive continuum that we want homeless people to have access to. So, Haven for Hope is the city's primary homeless investment, and we do encourage the homeless and people nearing homeless to seek services there because they're comprehensive and transformative. And we encourage you to also, as you touch the homeless, in a lot of ways you're the front line, and you have access and you have relationships with homeless individuals. And so we do encourage you to help the homeless seek those opportunities. And part of the reason we're here today is to have that discussion. And so we want to dive right into our conversation and get started on that. And so I'm going to turn it right back over to Tony.
Thanks, Melanie. So now what we're going to do for about the next hour and a half is have a conversation. And the conversation is going to begin with what are the opportunities and challenges of feeding the homeless and the hungry? Because I don't want to repeat myself. I'm saying homeless, but I'm also talking about people who are hungry, because I think a lot of people serve them also, right? So it's not just, but for shorthand, I'm going to say homeless instead of going through the whole thing. But I am trying to include anybody who's hungry out there who doesn't, okay? So the first question, and Lady's going to help me. So what we decided to do is split the room in half. So I'm going to be looking at this half, you're mine, and that half is hers. So you got to catch our eye. We have enough time. I'm going to ask everybody to limit your comments to about 1 minute. But I have four questions, okay, that we have to get through in an hour and a half. And if everybody wants to have something to say, you get about a minute. Let's try not to go over 2 minutes, please, okay? We're going to do a parking lot. Today we're talking about feeding the homeless and hungry people. That's all we're going to talk about, okay? If there's other stuff that you want to talk about, we're going to put it in a parking lot. Because one of the things we'd like to see come out of this meeting is to have some, how many people don't need to go to another meeting? That would be me. Okay, but we want to meet with you and have these conversations on an infrequent basis, okay? So we're going to ask you to do that. And we'll put these things on a parking lot and get back to them at a later time. Is that okay? Right? I'm going to ask that we speak one person speaks at a time. We're not here to challenge each other. We're here to provide facts and information. We've got all these folks here listening to you today. It's a great opportunity. So speak slowly, try not to talk too long, one person at a time. All the ideas are great ideas. There are no bad ideas in this room, okay? And we're gonna get as many as we can. We have people here scribing and taking notes, okay? So don't worry about taking notes. There is a survey on your table. I'm going to tell you about it now, but I want you to pay attention now. But before you leave today, if you could fill that survey out and leave it on the table, and we'll compile it. We want to know how we did today. So your first question is?
It's hard to get an edgewise with Tony, but there are six seats up here. If those of you who are sitting in the back want to participate in a more integrated manner, you're welcome to come take these chairs.
There's room on your survey form to leave comments. Don't be shy, okay? Because I'm going to go. So what would you like to tell us today? And then the two questions are, what are the challenges and what are the opportunities for feeding people in the community? And I am going to call on you just to get us started. You can pass if you'd like. Okay. Anybody who'd like to start? Yes, sir.
I find myself at a little bit of a disconnect.
Could you stand up and speak?
Yeah, I find myself at a disconnect. I've been feeding the homeless and doing drawings and paintings of them. And finding that I'm a citizen of San Antonio and finding that it's, you know, I find that it's illegal to feed the homeless. Many of the people that are on the streets that are homeless, there's people that suffer from not wanting to be inside, you know, not liking to be around people and things of that sort. And, you know, I guess I'm just wondering, a lot of the council members, were you the ones that drafted up the actual formal complaint to make it, you know, to push it all forward to make it legal to feed the homeless in San Antonio? Because I go out there every winter to feed the homeless, and I find it kind of awkward that the city of San Antonio is, drafting up things, making it.
I'm not sure that we're here to talk about the legality of it. I think we're here to talk about.
Necessarily to follow all these regulations that are put on, and even my organization, Church Forest on Main Street, Travis Park United Methodist Church, we hear talk that the food bank's going to require every volunteer that goes into our kitchen to get a food handler's permit. Okay, the city. That's not cost effective for us. We get thousands of different volunteers every month, you know, hundreds, I guess, different volunteers coming in and out every month. If we have to pay for them ourselves, which would what would end up be happening, that's just not in our budget right now.
Thank you very much. I have a young lady over here.
Yes, the
young lady behind you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Hi, so Alyssa Bean again from First Presbyterian Church. We do a feeding program the last Sunday of every month. One thing that I would, this is taking the conversation a little bit different direction, but I'd be interested if we could compile a list to know who is doing what and when. We feed the last Sunday of every month, but if somebody comes on a Sunday morning to church and wants to be fed, I would love to be able to recommend, and I know even on Sundays, after we have loads of fishes, and these people a pretty sizable meal, and sometimes they go down to take under the bridge, or some people go take the streets on Fridays and Saturdays. So I just would like to get a better idea of what when. And one of the concerns that we have started to have, especially like yesterday we had our ministry and two people pass out with the heat and other things, is what we are feeding the homeless, especially with a lot of them being diabetic or having different health issues. Again, I know any food is good food for somebody who's hungry, but if there are ways that we can provide healthier options, that's something that we can start to talk about what's the best way to do that. And I'd be interested if any of you are doing that, what recommendations you might have for us.
Sorry, comments. Thank you very much. I think over here we had more hands.
My turn. At St. Vincent Paul, we do the corporate feed, but we haven't done a past what we get this one. We're very concerned about the nutrition of the particular folks that we feed. In our view, is they have a special diet, special stresses, and everything else. And we're looking for ways that we can, and this is where this group here can help us, set up sort of a nutritional goal. So we're feeding everything that should be fed. And that's what we're looking for. We're trying to change our ways, but I think it'll be good for everybody else too.
Okay, thank you. So I have this gentleman that I said no earlier. Did you have something?
Yeah, I just wanted to add on kind of what was said a minute ago. I've eaten in Haven, I've eaten in a lot of other organizations. There are, every time I eat on the street, I never get sick. I go to Haven, I go to the Courtyard, pain does. I've eaten with, Brother Brian, I've eaten with Mark, I've eaten with Miss Diane, I've eaten at Travis Park. Probably almost every organization in this room, I've eaten at least once, and I never get sick, but I go to Haven, and all of a sudden, I get sick. I don't understand why the city wants to push everybody towards something that's going to make them sick. I don't understand.
Why make it sound that's working?
Thank you. Hi, I'm Joan Peter with the Child Train. I'm also a train chef and do have my food manager's safety license. And five of my volunteers have food safety, food handling permits. If the city, I'm surprised to know that there's no law against feeding the homeless, because yeah. Boy, I wish I'd known that 13 weeks ago.
But right.
It would have saved a lot of grief and a lot of name calling from the city. But I'm here to work forward with the city. If they are really interested in food safety, then the ordinance needs to be revised. It needs to exempt exemptions for faith-based, Good Samaritan, charitable operations. What we are willing to do in order for the city not to make us criminals, not to have $2,000 fines, Class C misdemeanors, we are willing to, and we have many organizations have already done this, and Good Samaritans, take a food safety class by the city for free, offered four times a year, valid for 2 years, have every Good Samaritan individually, if they want to do that, take that class either by the city or online. Like I said, make it free so it's not a permit fee generating issue. And there be a certified food handler in every organization during the preparation and the distribution of food. To my knowledge, there has not been one problem with the Chowtrain or these other ministries. I know the city knows that this ordinance on the books now is against the law. You cannot make a Good Samaritan into a criminal. You cannot give tickets to Good Samaritans. And let me just say about this violation for serving food out of an unpermitted personal vehicle. I would like to ask, why does every restaurant delivery service, Domino's Pizza, Jimmy John's, caterers, there is not a permit that this city issues for that. Although I was given a ticket for a ordinance, for violating an ordinance that does not exist. So with goodwill, with a lot of patience, with a lot of faith, I present to the city a revision that I prepared along with my lawyers from the national firm of Aiken Gump. Here's what we worked on. If food safety is really the concern, then let's amend it.
Also financial resources.
Thank you. Our
kind of the challenge that I'm coming up with is there's more families that have a home that they're not exactly sleeping on the streets, but they're hungry in their homes, and they come to my back door to get food.
So as I said, I work for United Way, and we actually manage that 211 line, and that the food insecurity issue keeps popping up for us pretty consistently. So.
Just redundant, I just because the city council is here, Haven for Hope, bless someone about to be here. From my time being there and talking with the residents, many of the residents there complained that they've been sick on numerous occasions. And within that, many people that I talked with, they said there's not enough food being served. So if it's about food safety, and this is feeding the homeless, and it's really about food safety, I think we have to start at the core where it's being fed and the city's paying for it first. Just a point.
Yes, my name is Paul with Guardian Angels. My wife and I have been feeding the homeless for a number of years, down at Maverick Park. We do feed nutritious meals. We've been feeding twice a week on Mondays and Wednesdays. And one of the things I was wondering is it okay to feed at the park? You know, it's a nice setting. It has picnic tables under the gazebo, and it's safe and it's out in the open. We feed all year long. Rain, sleet, cold, or hot. A lot of the people that come there, you know, the homeless know where everybody feeds. You know, they know where Brian is. You know, they know where Joan is. They know where we are. They know where Church Under the Bridge is. They know where, you know, the ministry taking it to the street. And a lot of times they come to our feeding, a lot of the people, they come from Haven for Hope. And they come to our feeding because they say they haven't had enough food over there. They didn't get enough food. And, you know, I've never been to Haven for Hope, and I'm just going by what they say. And so, you know, if we can be a supplemental, you know, food source for them, you know, that's what a lot of us actually do is, you know, we're not a supplemental food source, but, you know, we actually feed them a full course meal, plus cold water, and encouragement, and all the other things that go along with the feeding. It's not just the physical, but I know you don't want to get into all that. Yes, and sometimes we give people rides back to their camps, because you have a lot of the homeless that are campers, and you have some homeless that, you know, they just became homeless and they don't know what to do. And so that, you know, that's where I hear that Haven for Hope can give certain kind of services for that. And you, like she said, there are families who come. The whole family comes there. Mm-hmm. And we have to feed the whole family. So, you know, I'm just saying that that's one of the challenges, and that's one of the opportunities is to be a, you know, contributing food source for these people.
Mike Russell with Kingdom Streets Ministry. One issue that I haven't heard addressed yet is something that we hear in a resounding fashion from a lot of folks that we serve is with regard to existing services and existing feedings that they often go to, that there is a kind of a dehumanization that takes place. There's not a lot of dignity. It's very personal. They're hurt like cattle. They're treated like animals in their lives. A lot of metaphors along those lines. For someone who living on the street, struggling to maintain any sorts of identity, it would certainly seem that kind of thing would tend to further push them further down the road of dealing with an issue. So that's certainly a challenge and obstacle that we've addressed.
I think I want to say thank you to the gentleman because dignity, we forget about dignity, respect, and compassion, and I think we need to do that with everybody that we serve. For the Catholic Church, we have a major issue, Mr. Spoke with God, we see that the charities and the parishes, that the people come and ask for food, it's tough. It's like not people, but it was last year, who served 1,700 homeless this past year at our charities. We just opened an office downtown, we served 500 people coming for food there. So when I see Heaven for Hope, thank God that we're partnering, we're trying to do partnerships with all of us together. But that's $6 million. And I wonder everybody else in this room how much money is getting from the city to get food to the homeless people. I mean, I'm thinking of United Way, we get subsidized by United Way. And the city is actually subsidizing the program. But I think there's a lot of people who are trying to do new things. And just as, for instance, we just opened an organic garden in the west side. We asked for money, we couldn't get any money. But people are coming now, learning how to actually grow their own food so they can eat themselves. If they come to Catholic Charities, the food pantries, we try to teach them, you know, ESL classes, you know, GED classes, we get them clothes, we get them counseling, because we know that we need to get to the root of the problem. Because now we're going to get a lot more people, all of you guys, we are going to get a lot more people asking for food, and we're not going to be able to do it. So I think we need to start looking to what are the main causes of this, and what can we do to actually eliminate this problem.
Other challenges and opportunities.
Yes, in the center.
Brian Wicks with Resurrection Ministries. I don't have any particularly challenge feeding the homeless. I've been doing it for 18 years out of a home kitchen, out of a personal vehicle without any incident. The only challenge is you know, dealing with their homeless issues. One thing I'd really like the city to understand, and I'm sure I speak for a lot of the ministries in the room, when we provide all the food, the inference has been made in the past in various articles that all we provide is momentary sustenance and that we're not connecting people to comprehensive services. Well, when I'm out there feeding food, and I'm a minister, I'm about the gospel, I'm teaching them biblical principles, because the main cause I see for the homelessness issue is inner spiritual things that need to change on the inside of them, mindset changes to make better decisions, right? To want to get out of homelessness. Some of the people that we deal with, the chronic homeless, some of the times that don't even want to go to Haven because of all the rules and regulations. They're not just Haven, it's not just beat up Haven. You know, the other institutional areas, they're going to come to people like me. And maybe in the course of ministering to them and dealing with their issues and counseling them and talking to them about these kinds of inner changes, we might be getting some of those people to the place where maybe I'll try that place over there and try some of the other services. Which, by the way, if there's a service that I can't offer, I've directed people, well, for that you need to go to Haven. Well, I hear the Salvation Army does that thing, you know. Now, as far as the law goes, and it's hard not to focus on that, because we all know that's the main reason we've all ended up in this room, because of all this hubbub, which has happened ever since the opening of Haven for Hope. As I said, I've been doing this for 18 years. This has never, ever been an issue until 5 years ago. This thing about following in line with vendor codes. The food codes were tweaked to accommodate us as vendors. Then they were retweaked to accommodate us as food handlers. And I'm with Joan, you know. I've cooked for, since I was 13. I have taken a food safety course. I'm not a licensed chef. But I know how to handle food safely, and I know how to bring out good, hot, healthy food. I think anybody would be willing to just take that simple course, forget about all the vehicle permit, the kitchen to cook it out of. Because everybody in ministry that does this is very conscientious about good food, are we not?
Right.
I mean, there is not a list that we know of homeless people that have ended up at the emergency room for eating dangerous food, poisonous, tainted food. We don't have bodies for sweeping off the streets that have passed out because the food was bad. That list just isn't there. I maintain that, and I want to be careful about this, but it's always looked as though when this all first began, in the zeal to move everybody from one place to the other, to move them particularly out of the downtown areas, this food issue is a weapon to try to curtail our efforts.
Mm-hmm.
What I would really like to see is some honesty and some admission that that's what was being done, that this issue has never really been about food. It has been about the homeless we feed and where we feed them. Because we have nobody coming up on us with any problems outside the downtown border. It's only when we cross that border that we have a police roll up on us. And if there's any challenge, hopefully that's going to end with all recent events and today's meeting, is looking over our shoulder whether or not a squad car is going to pull up. Thank you.
I'm going to move to the next question. So I'm going to get one round of last comments.
And you're okay, this I just like to speak on Brother Pastor Brian. I was homeless when I met him 15 years ago. Today I have a home, but I still struggle with food. But I still feed the homeless from my back door. Brother Pastor Brian and his organization and the people that work with him helped me build my self-esteem, helped me feel better about myself, gave me unconditional love, and they brought me food when I was sick and hungry. And that's all it is, unconditional love.
Any last comments?
I'm Andy Gray. I'm chairman and assistant pastor of Church on the Bridge. I would say that the question is very simple. And it's simple of how do we weigh the common sense and the common good? And I think that's what we're trying to figure out today is how do we weigh the common sense of us not wanting to impede someone's ability to come out and to provide love and affection and dignity to someone that's on a street, and that may be the real bill that they get all day, with the common good of making sure that what we're giving them isn't something that's going to make them sick. And I agree with what everybody said. I don't know of any place, and I've been at CUP for 10 years, I don't know of any time that someone's got sick with us, but rather to the point, I like Ms. Cheever's idea of saying, well, maybe the city could do something like that, the handler's permit. We don't want to be in the business, I would think it's the city. We don't want to be in the business of keeping people from loving on their brothers and sisters that are in the city that are less fortunate. So we need to be about a solution developed to help them do that, and maybe the right way is that. But weighing the common good and the common sense are something that I think is what we're butting up against, and how to do that. And there's got to be a way for us all to reach the same goal, because I come across people all the time that think that they're not important. I would like to show them a snapshot of this room. All these people in one place, that's just what's here, that are interested and showing love and compassion to the people that are on the streets. And that's what we all want to do. But we've got to figure out how to interlace and interweave the common sense of the common good. How we can go about keeping people to be able to feed, but not restricting them to do that, and keeping them healthy. Some of these folks, y'all know as well as I do, will eat out of their dumpsters. They are worth our best efforts to give them the best meal we possibly can, and the best way that we can do it. But that's something we've got to keep in our mind. Is that if we don't give them something, sometimes they'll go someplace else. So how do we balance that? And I think that's our question.
All right, going once, challenges and opportunities.
One last thing, we're finding in our society that we operate 67 parish-based conferences, and we daily address feeding operations for both the homelessness. I personally visit dumpsters and give out Chipotles when we get, and things like that. But it's those folks will never come downtown. We need to really look at, you know, getting them in the neighborhoods, and we sometimes sack lunches and stuff like that. But that's a big issue that's growing, and with reputation, you know, or just the word that gets around, they do not want to come downtown. So we have to take care of it.
Last comment to that.
J. George, Grace Episcopal Church. One of the things that I see as we sit around this room is something that Haven for Hope has already started and done some good at is the possibility of creating partnerships. What if the issue is downtown and the real issue is protecting property and environment, not really about food safety, then why not create some opportunities for downtown property owners, for downtown businesses, to partner with some of these ministries who are serving people who are right there at their doorsteps? Why not create some other ways for SAPD to partner with some of these ministries? There are a lot of really really great people in the police department in this city. They're amazing, these men and women. Maybe there's some ways that we can create opportunities for them to partner with these ministers. I don't know what the answers are, but I know that there are answers here in this room because of the work that's already being done, the ministry that's already being done. And there are other opportunities that we just haven't tapped because we all exist in these lanes and we don't cross over and find opportunities to work together.
Go ahead,
I like it. Mark Johnson with Taking It to the Streets. And my question or my challenge that we get a lot on Friday and Saturday nights is very simple. I mean, the stuff that Brian talked about and Mike talked about, I mean, that's good stuff. I'm not that smart, so I'm going to keep it real quick. We have challenges with restrooms and the places that we teach. So we get asked quite a bit on both sides of the table where they can go to the bathroom. So I wonder if maybe at the parks it might be an opportunity to put in public bathrooms so that we're not having our volunteers trying to go into businesses or even the people on the street for that matter going into hotels, restaurants, and asking them to use their facilities. Otherwise, they're doing things they shouldn't on the streets in front of businesses. They shouldn't be in front of doing those things. So, you know, when they get a ticket, then it just starts a wheel, and they just spiral down because they got now on record. So maybe a public bathroom might be something.
That is a big issue, a very big issue.
Yeah. And a big need, because you ask any homeless person, most of those downtown businesses are going to refuse them to use the bathroom. And there are very few public restrooms. And, you know, it's either the ground or your pants. So, I mean, I don't want to be crude, but what are you going to do? We try to tell them to be conscientious about that, get somewhere where there's a bathroom, but that's they're just not available as they should be.
In New York, they have portable bathrooms that you can go into the bathroom, clean up, and come back out, and it's in there on like every six blocks or something. Yeah, and they're free. And they're free and they're kept clean.
Next question. So how many of y'all are actually feeding folks? Quick show of hands. Okay, so what I'd like to ask real quickly is a location, and do you have a scheduled time? Like you're there on Mondays at 10 o'clock, I made that up, okay? But if you don't mind, we just want to get a record real quick of it, so we just sort of turn around by table and hear that. I think that's a first step towards the coordination.
One person per organization.
I'm sorry. The Christian Assistance Ministries serves Monday through Friday, and we prepare 75 sandwiches. What we're finding is that it's usually the same people that are coming. But I'd also like to comment, can someone put this on to Sarah? Because I'm going to start going to Sarah. Because we don't serve on holidays and we don't serve on Saturdays and Sundays, and I often worry about our clients and where are they going. And then another, just real briefly since I'm speaking to the council, I would advise that we do this in every district, just what you're doing here in every district, because we also have a Days of Olive location. We're finding that there are many homeless in the Days of Olive location as well. We're seeing more and more expanding out. So I would like each district to be able to commit, have a committee, have someone that is looking at homeless issues.
Thank you.
Church and the Bridge, we feed three nights a week, Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday night, but we also have a small contingent on Monday nights. And when you come back around to it, I really want to talk about the Sarah Board, because I'm also on the board of directors. And I think that, you know, there's a lot of people in here. We get to be really territorial, but the answer is to have a coalition, is to have all of us together. It's so that we all know what each other is doing. It's really, really important, those of you who have never been to a Sarah Board or are not a member of the Sarah Board, that you come, because we are the homeless services. We are the umbrella and the coalition for this entire community in Bexar County. And instead of us fighting each other or not knowing about each other, we really need to come together in one room every month in the forums that we have and say, hey, I can cover that because it's not a service that's provided by somebody else. Also, we do a directory that has a lot of us on camps on it. There's a lot of the big shelters and a lot of the small shelters. And and some of your feeding services already on that directory. But we need all of us so that everyone can walk away with a small directory and say, okay, this is the days, these are the times, this is the locations.
So I'm going to volunteer Andrew to help you put that together. Andrew runs the Chemung One locally. And so we're going to be always going to help you put that together.
You got that?
Yeah, so somebody asked, one of the people who's writing just asked me to ask you to tell you if there's times, if it's in a certain time frame.
Yeah, 6 o'clock. 6 p.m. Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Sunday evening at the
Church
and Bridge.
Yeah, just 7:44.
7:44 Chestnut.
We've been 7 days a week, of course, at
We are.
St. Vincent Paul at Haven, and most of our conferences have food distribution. Especially at church-based location, and we serve foods two or three times a week, depending on.
Is it published?
Yes, we have it published.
We can get back to you on the
phone. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Information for every person on the street where they can get a hot meal or get a meal. So I believe in communicating. So that's it.
Bill Paul at Pleasant Bridge. We serve every Sunday for the last 27 years at for Pleasant Austin underneath I-37. We'll just love the outside. 50 every Sunday morning.
Karen Bell with Mobile Loaves and Fishes, and we serve almost every Monday through Thursday, pretty much breakfast, lunch, and dinner at Catholic Worker House, and then some Fridays at Catholic Worker House, like twice a month, and a couple of weekends at Rescue Mission.
What specific times? Breakfast is 8 to 10, lunch is 11:30, and supper is at 5:30. And we also serve on holidays, if they fall on a holiday, including Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. We do not serve on Thanksgiving. And we also have a list that we give to all members. We have 2,100 members with all of these, but I see now that we have left some off the list. And I'd be glad to email that list, but it's, I think, all of them that are listening. So we do it collaboratively.
Catholic Charities Guadalupe Community Center. We serve walk-in bases on Monday through Friday, 8 to 5. We collaborate with local loaves and fishes with one of the parishes. They give us 75, and anything that it seats that we provide out of our pantry at any given time, including clothing.
Did we miss anybody? Anybody else? Okay, so. Has anybody thought of any more opportunities now that you've heard that? What opportunities are there? I want to say thank you to all you guys that are doing that. It's important work, and just personally, I want to say thank you very much. So, our last question. Do you currently coordinate with any other organizations while providing feeding? I heard a little bit. But I'm going to change it up. Do you deliberately coordinate with any other organizations in feeding people? Yes, ma'am.
Do you find coordination? Is that a two-way or just
referrals.
I think coordination is always a two-way street. I think it's sort of like dancing, actually.
Yes, we coordinate with Brian. He goes on Tuesdays and Thursdays. That's the reason we go on Mondays and Wednesdays, so we can coordinate so that the homeless can have a meal every day, you know, from Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. And then the ministry taking it to the street, they go on Fridays and Saturdays. And it's all at about the same time, and it's all in the same general area.
So you guys talk amongst yourselves. Do you tend to feed the same folks? That's just curiosity.
Yeah, how many people is that group feeding about? We're seeing about like 300, so I'm just curious what other people.
Well, we generally have anywhere from 15 to 40, depending on what day of the month it is and the weather.
Not on purpose, but it seems to have always been kind of an unwritten law that we've all adhered to, particularly in the days when the Livingstones used to be in operation. We typically try not to infringe on each other's time. Everybody knows when everybody's feeding, and if you have any question about who's feeding where, all you got to do is ask your neighborhood homeless person. They know who everybody is. They got the schedule down. They can tell you what bus to get on to get there. We don't want to be doing something while somebody else is, because we want to infringe on their opportunity. And we just have always kind of, I'm Tuesday and Thursday night, so is church under the bridge, but I'm later, they're earlier. You know, we just always try to make it where everybody's got their space, and we don't have to call each other to do that, as far as I know.
You just know.
Yes,
ma'am.
This is changing the subject a little bit, but what we found under the bridge is people, especially with disabilities, getting from the east side of San Antonio over to the west side of San Antonio. We have people on crutches, we have people in wheelchairs, powered wheelchairs, all kinds of people with physical disabilities. And so that's an issue.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
We have a lot of partners in that. We have experienced over time that a lot of churches, one who are outside the downtown area, looking for a place to serve and work. So we have our own little coalition of folks that want to. They prepare food, or they work. They come down there and serve the food and get the experience of it with that. And so this is the partnership. They get the opportunity to serve, and at the court we get the food to serve. Because we don't get any federal or city money. Food banks, but we basically get, it's all donations. So that's what we do. We get the opportunities for the folks beyond the downtown.
Right. Any other questions?
So back to the opportunity piece of the question. Would it be possible for the city to offer churches, ministries, nonprofits, even a discounted bus ticket for a weekly or monthly discount? Discounted bus. Unprofitable. So, Mark Johnson, thank you for the speech. My question again was, is there a possibility or an opportunity where the city could provide ministries, churches, discounted bus tickets, you know, whether it be daily, weekly, bi-weekly, monthly? Is that an option that maybe the city can
consider? I think that we provide hundreds of bus passes a month, and I would love a reduced rate for road. Because they need to get somewhere, or they have a doctor's appointment, they have no way to get there, or whatever, they need to go and get social
services. Well, that's a great idea, but it's a little off subject, but I'm going to hold myself responsible for getting back to you two on that.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Mark.
Somebody asked them. You wouldn't be
they're going to hold me accountable. Okay, and then they'll get back to you.
They are. I have her name. So
that's right. We have.
We have relationships, as Brian mentioned, with the food pantry. We also, the food bank, I'm sorry. And we do have relationships with other people, primarily for our Wednesday evening program and our Sunday morning program. Wednesday evening, we have a number of other church groups or even students from Trinity University, for example, who come and volunteer and help provide the meals. And then on Sunday mornings, in addition to feeding folks, we have a medical clinic. So we have a relationship with medical personnel, students at University of Texas who come in and provide those services.
Great. Can I get all that to you? Any other comments on this subject? Any other challenges or opportunities? You didn't forget anything?
Well, just basically what was already said, Hayden for Hope has an opportunity, or the people, the city, who gives money there. How wonderful would it be to have satellites, Hayden for Hope satellites, to different areas of the city so someone could go bathe, so someone could go do some laundry. It's all in that direction, and we're so limited. Kim has partnerships with 70 churches, where one of the first started in the downtown area to serve the homeless. We are now serving two populations which are at risk, and it's those individuals that are living on someone's sofa, eating out of their refrigerator. They're still homeless, but we try to get those groceries. Then we have people that are actually living on the streets. But how wonderful if we could pull some of that money and some of those resources and bring them outside where other people can be on east side, south side, west side, and the north side. We cannot be blinded to the idea that there aren't homeless there. We see them every day.
Okay, so I'm going to get to you in 1 second. I'm going to tell you where I want to go, and because we're actually a little bit ahead of time. So I'm going to let this go for maybe another 5 or 10 minutes. Okay, but then I'd like to really hone in on coordination. And how do we do a better job communicating? Okay, not just with all of you guys in this room, but maybe even with the folks you're serving. To ensure some better coordination. So I want to have a sidebar conversation about that, but let's finish this. So yes, sir.
You know, the thing is, from the homeless standpoint, I live in all over the city. If you're outside of the downtown area, your chances of eating are very, very limited. There's a lot of places that the homeless are right now that they eat out of dumpsters because that's all they have. You know, everybody wants to say, but they're downtown, they're downtown, they're downtown. They're going to go where the, you know,
the food is.
They're going to go where the food is. Why can't we set up what we do downtown in other locations? You know, I was talking to Mark the other day, and I said, you know, it used to be on Friday and Saturday nights you were left out until the organization came in and said, you know, we'll take Friday night. Then they came back and they said, we'll take Saturday night. And then now, with Paul coming back on Monday, you know, Monday's going to be taking care of the homeless. You know, we're making some strides as far as, you know, the services that are available, but they're still not enough. If you're put out of Haven, there's nowhere to take a shot. In San Antonio, there's no other place to take a shower if you're put out of here.
Shower traps park here. You can get there early on Sunday morning.
Okay. I will just get ready to correct that because I looked at mine again. But I mean, you know, that there needs to be other avenues.
I'm hearing shower and laundry. Okay, I don't know if everybody heard that. Shower and laundry.
I'm sorry, you have that. Yeah. I guess I had a question for one of the police
police officers, is it illegal for somebody to ask for money or change on the streets? Do you get a ticket?
That's interesting.
And who's giving or anything?
The aggressive resident.
I'm sorry, didn't hear the answer.
Aggressive panhandling versus just panhandling.
I'm sorry, could you stand up one second? You said aggressive panhandling.
Versus.
Didn't hear you.
Shut up.
What we're talking about is panhandling versus aggressive panhandling, asking somebody for money is not illegal. Pushing them, shoving them, getting in the face, making them uncomfortable, yeah, that's aggressive panhandling.
Okay, then, I'm sorry, but then why are people getting tickets for asking for cigarettes? And not aggressively, if that's the case. I mean, you say it's not illegal here, but out there on the street, it is. You get tickets for it.
There was people complaining about that.
I was harassed the other morning walking down Commerce because I asked a friend of mine if he had 50 cents I could borrow to run to the bank real quick. I was harassed for that.
So I'm going to put panhandling on our parking lot to get back to. Right now we're just talking about feeding. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I have a question and a statement. And it's about communicating. So I think I'm in the right parking lot here. I have found from anecdotal evidence people talking to me. I know Chief McMahon has tried in September to give a ticket to Good Samaritans, and that was not even discussed in Quality of Life Committee, and he said he was going to engage in a PR campaign. Well, I've come to find out that individual Good Samaritans in the city are going into restaurants and fast food chains with the homeless and offering to buy a hamburger, putting in an order or a taco, and have been told by the restaurant manager that SAPD has been around telling the restaurant managers and the cashiers that it is a crime. And if that is true, then we have a bigger problem than we think, which is a federal civil rights violation. And if there needs to be some re-education with the SAPD, who I love, by the way, they have my back all the time, I'm gonna have theirs. But if there's a whispering campaign to tell restaurant managers and cashiers that it is illegal for a Good Samaritan to buy a meal for a person in need, then we need to address that issue pretty quickly before it explodes.
If I can respond to that, John, I can tell you emphatically, that is not true at all. I mean, we're not giving that direction. Chief McKay, that is not something that we're putting out for our officers.
Okay, will you please let the restaurants and the fast food chains know that? Because I'm hearing other things.
Let me know, we'll address
that. Okay, get a list to you. Thank you.
Okay, one last round. Okay, I want to just take a little minute. I'm going to put Scott Ackerson, John Haverhill on the spot and ask him to address some of the coordination issues that have been raised here.
So I've got obviously a lot of challenges, a lot of opportunities, and working on collaborations. Number one, I was at a street feeding summit 6 years ago before Haven for Hope even was open. And some of the same issues and concerns were brought up. And I will tell you, it was a very different organization at that time. The administration at Haven was very prescriptive in how they wanted you to behave, what they wanted you to do. And I'm telling you, it's a different culture and a different climate now. I've met with several of your organizations. I already told Mark I was going to put him on the spot, but I've met with Taking It to the Streets Ministry, and the first time that Mark and Mike came to the campus, they kind of looked at me like, okay, what do you want now? What do you want now? It really was an invitation to collaborate. And I said, I don't know what I want. I know that we need help. We have 1,500 people on that campus experiencing homelessness at any given night, and we can't do it all. And so talk about opportunity. There's great opportunity for collaboration in this room. So working with Taking It to the Streets Ministries, they're now under contract with my other hat, the Center for Healthcare Services, to do some evaluation about what's working on the campus, particular to the courtyard, what improvements need to be made, and then they'll be talking to people that they're feeding on the street too, to say, what keeps you from coming to the courtyard? We're a learning, growing organization. If you haven't been to Haven in the past couple of years, and you have my personal invitation to please come and see what's different. We've got some fairly monumental changes happening at the courtyard. The original vision of the courtyard was safe sleeping, get people off the streets. We're now really looking at how do we effectively engage people. We're opening an integrated care clinic to provide for mental health needs, physical health needs. We're expanding all of the permanent roof line on the courtyard. We're trying to do some beautification on the courtyard. We've acquired a building across the street from the courtyard to provide additional services to the people experiencing homelessness on the courtyard, as well as job opportunities and sort of a step-up facility that's a climate-controlled facility. So if you haven't been to the campus lately, I would invite you, and I will personally give you a tour, show you around, show what some of the changes are. And one of the messages I've heard from many of the people that are feeding on the street is partly about food and hunger, but it's partly about service, engagement, and fellowship. One of the challenges is many of your organizations don't have capacity to feed 500 and 600 people, which is 500, 600, 700, which is what we're feeding on the corridor. I think as a community, we have capacity to feed those 500, 600, 700 and to create other methods to feed the marginally housed, those that have to choose a meal over paying rent. So I think there's great opportunity in this room, and I think this is our first opportunity to really think strategically, how do we all work together to make this happen? So I would address any questions you might have. Yes?
Can you give me your name again?
Yes, my name is Scott Ackerson, A-C-K-E-R-S-O-N.
Thank you. Scott, it seems like this sort of set outside the line a little bit here too. I had the privilege of going to Austin with Scott a few months back to put the community first program that they've initiated up there, hopefully is now up and running. I haven't heard the final status on it at this point, but part of the resolution for helping address the problem of homeless on the street and feeding homeless would be to provide opportunities to move beyond homelessness. And it looks like we might have an opportunity to implement some of the Whole House First programs that are beginning in various cities around the country, California, Utah, Austin, where you provide opportunities for people to get off the street. Not everybody. You look at them and find people who have the desire to do that, to move in that direction, and that as a group, we could provide a collaborative effort to make that happen.
Absolutely, and there are Housing First dollars that will be coming through the continuum. And part of the rationale of why I took the job with the center, so I worked with Center for Healthcare Services and Haven for Hope, because the center oversees the courtyard. And frankly, many of you know, I was one of the more outspoken critics of the courtyard. So what I learned is, if you complain long enough about something, they put you in charge of it. With a lot of work with the South Alamo Regional Alliance for the Homeless, we're really starting to try to target the courtyard and target chronic homeless. And one of the strategies for that is the Housing First Initiative, which requires intensive wraparound supports that, frankly, Haven by itself is not able to provide. But as a community collaborative, we can certainly provide those supports. And Cortisone Ministries was another group that we've had multiple conversations about how do we start to work together again, because we had a disconnect 5 years ago, and we're really trying to rebuild those bridges and partnerships with the community.
I'm fairly new to Mobile Loaves and Fishes as a core team member. I've just been a volunteer that made sandwiches in the kitchen a few times ago. But I know that Mobile Loaves and Fishes founder, Mr. Graham in Austin, Mobile Loaves and Fishes is probably the largest, the last numbers I saw, they were the largest organization serving homeless in in Austin. They also have a program housing program, incorporating the homeless, building their own homes. And it might be something that those are in charge in this city looking at getting those who want homes, a home. It might be worth talking to those in Austin about that.
That project is called Community First, and taking it to the Streets Ministry hosted us in Quota Zone. I know a couple of our city councilmen are interested in going up to take a visit. I believe Councilman Trevino, for sure. So we're making arrangements to make that happen. We're looking at it as a potential model, and it's particular to chronic, and it's sort of, for lack of a better term, a sanctioned encampment. I mean, people are looking for community, and so if the only place they're finding community is an encampment, and that's what they want, how do we help them to get that home and that community?
Scott, thanks for letting me pick on this one.
Absolutely.
Any other questions? So you guys have been really productive. Do you think that this was helpful? I know I asked you in the survey, and everybody completed the survey, I'm sure, right? But was this useful? Was this helpful to have this conversation? Would you like to do it again? Is it something that getting you all hang it out? And maybe Scott, you could host us over at Haven.
We'd be happy to.
I'm not going to ask for one more round of comments from people who haven't had anything to say, if you would like.
Okay. Well, I'm speaking for the Samaritans in the city, so I think I can talk a little bit. But anyway, I do want to say that one of the reasons that my husband and I founded the Child Train was to show our children compassion. And it's hard to volunteer at some places when they have criminal background checks or age restrictions and everything else. So we started the Child Train to show, to model for our children like my parents modeled for me. And so it's not just one side of town. It's all over town. And it's where you find the homeless or hungry, working poor. We ought to be able to show our children that we can take care of them. Because as I tell our children, it's not just my responsibility or our generation responsibility. It's yours too, and the next generation too. So it's hard to show compassion when you're restricted in one area or by age limits. So I just want to say that's the reason why we founded Child Train.
Thanks for that. Any other last comments? Okay, some of you haven't had anything to say. So this is your chance to hop in and let us hear from you. Anybody? Yes, sir.
My name is Jeff Baldwin, and I'm with Hemisphere Park. I'm the director of operations, and got a manager with me today. I've just been, I think, inspired hearing the stories that everybody's telling. My job for the past 36 years has not been anywhere near downtown. I work with the tourists at SeaWorld. I work at Hemisphere, where we're ready to open up our first park. And we came here because we know we're going to be dealing with homeless. People are going to come visit the park, where they use our restroom when it opens. And we want to make sure we're treating them with compassion and making sure that we know how to best help them. And I just appreciate hearing everybody in this room. And I realize there's going to be a lot of resources that we're going to be able to reach out to make sure that we're supporting the efforts of the city. So I think it's been a very worthwhile afternoon. And I appreciate all the work that all of you did. Are doing and have been doing. So thank you for that.
Yes.
I'd like to take this time to extend the opportunity for you all as a ministry to come out on Sunday mornings to be a part of our unity service. You all feed, you all serve. Right now, on campus, I'm a pastor, United Methodist pastor, and we have about 200 to 225 that come to service every Sunday morning. We have a brunch, okay? We've been providing that brunch, but I would like to extend that opportunity for you all to be a part of that and come out and provide brunch for about 200 people. You can bring donations, hygiene kits, whatever it is you might want to bring. Most of all, we want you to come out and engage with these folks to bring them to your church on Sunday mornings. So afterwards, there's an opportunity for you to talk, to find out the needs, the wants of some of these individuals, and wrap around, because they're going to leave Haven for over one day. And like Scott said, it's 1,500 people on campus. And that unity service is not just for people on campus, it's for both courtyard and campus. So children are able to come and be a part of that. Engagement in that service is friendly, it's secure. Everybody can come and just extend what you have to offer on campus. Like Scott said, we're making a lot of different changes and a lot of different opportunities out there. And I hear the call for outside of downtown. Believe me, we feed hundreds of individuals through outreach at Haven for Hope, outside in those encampments, outside in the environments that where people don't want to come. You know, they don't want to pay, they can't get in town. So, and we also provide bus passes for individuals who might need to get to the doctor, who might need to make appointments. I know we provide them because I go get them. We pick them up and we do these things. We make down calls. We do all of these services. We're not just, we're out there to help. We're here to help. And we want you all to be a part of that. We want you all to extend your gifts and the things that you have to offer, to be a part of what we're doing, not just in downtown, but we're doing it in Bexar County, all over. So there's just a couple of us, and we can use your volunteer help and your resources to coordinate and to come together and be a part of the big picture, not just the little individual pictures, but the big picture, and that's to service those who are least needy. Okay? So I just want to extend that, 220-2114, that's my number. You can call it, you can coordinate, you can come out, 8:30 service start, 10 o'clock, we serving brunch.
And tell them who you are.
I'm Ron Brown, Pastor Ron Brown, at Haven for Hope. Thank you.
I just want to reintroduce myself. My name is Bill Hubbard. I'm executive director, newly appointed, newly selected for the South Alamo Regional Alliance for Homeless. And for those of you who would like to learn more about our collaboration efforts and our responsibilities under the federal HUD laws, I've got cards. I'd love to sit down and chat with you. I'd love to be part of the organization and part of the process of solving these problems. And I would also like to extend a personal thanks to every single one of you who are out there working with these folks, because they really need help. And our community needs you to do that every day. I've been involved with the City of San Antonio low-income projects since about 2000. I saw them build a couple of very good world-class projects in collaboration with this. And I think if we sit down, talk these issues through, look at the opportunities, overcome the challenges, we'll be part of the solution. We'll have a world-class model for an example to everybody else in a very short time. But I appreciate being invited. My thanks to the city for looking on the agenda. And I would tell you last, I will take this information back to the board, two of which my board members are here, and hopefully continue the conversation in a truly meaningful way to move this issue forward and get it solved so that we have fewer barriers to being good Samaritans. I love that. I love that term. Thank you.
Thanks. Anybody else?
So, Genevieve Noriego, San Antonio Food Bank. We work with a good number of you all here, but I also want to extend the invitation out to anybody else here. You can partner with us in a variety of ways, and we would love to make an impact on the people you're serving and just help you all make an impact in the community. So, call us, 337 Food, is our number. Please remember. But just ask for ways to partner, and we'd love to bring you in, discuss those ways you can partner, and take
it from there. So Andrew it works with us at United Way, and he oversees 211. And he took a lot of notes about location, and he just committed to me that he's going to have all that on our website, United Way website, for you guys to edit by tomorrow. Yes? For you guys to edit, okay, just make sure we got the information right, and then we'll give it to Mel, and we can figure out what to do with it from there, okay? I'm sorry, it's UnitedWaySATX.org.
Okay.
You can just, that's great. Any other comments? Okay, the chief would like to say a few words to you, so please welcome.
Thank you very much, and I will say from our standpoint,
Well, I just want to say from our standpoint, Haven for Hope has been a great partner, and so I want to say thank you to Scott and Pastor Brown. And really, I know that a lot of our officers have probably at some point in time have taken somebody that they came across that needed a meal that has taken them to one of y'all's locations. And so I appreciate that. And really, I think that a lot of times we see the issues and the concerns, but really this is a great opportunity to take advantage of everybody's efforts so that way to make sure that we're all pulling in the same direction. Because I think this is a true reflection of what makes San Antonio the great city that it is. And it's not police, it's not Haven for Hope, but it's everybody's unified effort that's gonna make a difference. Because we can talk about the feeding and how it's being done, but really it's about what can we do as a community, what can we do in partnership to work together to make it work for the members of our community that really struggle at times. And so rather than look at, well, not in my neighborhood, not in my community, we need to look at how we can do it as a community to serve our community. And so I just want to make that comment and just say I appreciate everybody that stood up and had different things to say, because really you all are a true reflection of what makes San Antonio the great community that it is. So I just want to say thank you.
I'll talk to you afterwards if you like. First, I just want to thank Police Chief Trevino and Councilman Nirenberg. I'm really proud to be working with people like that in our city who are willing to roll up their sleeves and get to work, find real solutions. And I think, you know, we hope that today is not just about talk. It's about action. We're going to do some things. So, you know, I want to just kind of go over some things I heard. If you don't mind, I'm going to just go over them real quick. I think we're kind of ahead of schedule, so I can eat up a lot of time. So the first thing that I heard that I thought was really great was we got to have the will. There's always going to be this issue with us, and so we got to have that will. And I think we're seeing it in this room. We really want to harness that. The second thing was just some of the great suggestions that Ms. Cheever brought out today, which I really like. You know, take a food safety class on the city, certified food handler, and so forth. And I think we can expand on that and look at some programs right away and know that, you know, we have the will to do that. The third is, and that's all it is, human dignity, right? I don't know how many issues I face at City Council that simply deal with that simple issue. In the end, what we're here to do is to represent people. And what that means is it's representing their dignity. So I hear you. I think we all hear you. The fourth thing is businesses to partner with ministries, maybe even San Antonio Police Department. I think that's a neat idea. That's really you know, something that we can explore. See how we can create partnerships. That's always a great solution. Collaboration, partnerships. I really like that one especially. I really like this one. Public bathrooms. You know, many of you all know that I'm an architect, and I've said it all along. There's nothing we can't fix with a little bit of good design. And so I'm publicly challenging local architects to help solve this one. This is solvable. I know it is. We've got to have a solution for public restrooms, one that works. It's a design solution. I'm calling out architects. The next one is related to what I do also, you know, disabilities. We talked about you know, the issues with people with disabilities. That's another big one. It's true. You know, a lot of the problems we see with people who have who have food insecurity have other issues as well. They have bad health. They're certainly going to have problems getting around. The night I spent at Haven for Hope, I saw something very simple, like foot fungus. Doesn't seem like a big deal, but I think anybody can tell you that that could quickly become an infection and become a big deal. And then that person ends up in the ER, and who knows what else from that point. So, you know, I think that that's really important. I'm glad somebody brought that up because, you know, accessibility is a huge issue. Accessibility really it dovetails nicely into, you know, what we call equality, equal access. And we should definitely address that. The seventh one was discounted bus tickets. Great idea. Really great idea. I think, you know, that's something we can certainly start implementing. Let's look at how we make that happen. Number eight, Haven for Hope satellites. What I like about that statement was that it's an admission that Haven for Hope is really doing something great, right? So we can model some great things, you know. So I think that's great. Haven for Hope satellites, I think it's a great idea. I've had the privilege of having breakfast with Reverend Ron Brown, and I think I got a lot of insight that morning, and I really appreciate your hard work at Haven for Hope and all that you do, and know that there's many people like Mr. Ron Brown at Haven for Hope, and you guys are an example here today. We talked about the issue of how outside of downtown eating is difficult, so it's an issue of proximity, and I think it kind of goes to that sort of idea of satellites. So we'll definitely be examining that, this idea of, you know, how we address some of these issues. I think downtown, the biggest issues with downtown have to do with the fact that that's where our city, sort of our heart is, the most dense part of our city. We have a lot of areas for people to exist. So we're going to have those issues. But on the satellite or on the perimeter areas of our city, it does become difficult to address feeding the hungry. The last one was one that I brought up when I spent the night at Haven for Hope, which was hygiene kits. I love it. I think we can do this. Mr. Brown already has some hygiene kits. I think we need to create, you know, a way to get more of these hygiene kits to these people. They could really use it. I saw it that night. I think we're going to start. I want to say that we did discuss potentially starting something in Prospect's courtyard overnight, where somebody can potentially go take a look at people with some hygiene issues, so that they can be addressed overnight. And so that I want to say what's really neat about that is that it shows how Haven for Hope is responding. They can't, you know, you can't have all the answers all at once. I mean, it's such a diverse issue, but you know, they do have medical facilities. They're just not open at night when people in Prospect's Courtyard are taking advantage of Prospect's Courtyard. But by listening to my experience there and how we could possibly have somebody there overnight, that's addressing part of that issue. So I want to say those are 10 things I wrote down. I know there's more. I got another note here from my facilitator and talked about, you know, the misinformation, how it's hunger is pervasive and increasing. And we got to share resources. You know, that's really, really key. We want to be partners. And this is what's most important of all. You know, us at City Council know that we're going to be looking into this, not just the Quality of Life Committee, but, you know, we'll make sure we'll be talking to other council members addressing this. This is a city issue, not a District 1 issue or District 8 issue. It's a city issue, and we'll be addressing those things. So just a couple notes that I wrote down too. Knowing that there's not going to be any easy answers, I think this is a great start. Let's leave with some takeaways. Let's implement some things right away. I want to acknowledge the great work at Haven for Hope and how amazing it was that it got started. You know, it got started with the compassionate efforts of treating the evacuees from Katrina, from New Orleans, and the great work that was done, Mayor Phil Hardberger, Bill Greehy, Patty Radel, and Cheryl Scully, know that there is compassion in the city. We're trying to find ways to make this work. So I thought about this a lot, and we hear about the Good Samaritan. And we have a lot of Good Samaritans in here, and I want to say this from the bottom of my heart. Good Samaritans should not have to be in service of the city. The city should be in service of the Good Samaritans. And what that means is we need to find ways to get you guys to help you do what you want to do, help you do the good that you do. And that's really important. So I just want to express that. But most importantly, I'm gonna end with what my mother said to me growing up. And it's a Mexican dicho. Some of you might have heard this one. Haz el bien sin mirar a quién. Have you all heard that? In English, it means do what is right, come what may. And I would say that's really a great message today. One last thing I want to leave you with, and it's a ritual that me and my great council aide, Jed Mabius, do every day, is we literally shake hands and we hug. And it seems like a silly thing, and I wasn't a big hugger growing up. But some of the best people hug. When I met Pastor Ron Brown, we hug. When I met Eric Cooper of the food bank, he hugs just like Jed Mabius. Really leans into it. So just know, you know, we want you to understand that we do have some compassionate people here. We are listening to you. And today, before you leave, shake somebody's hand, give them a good hug. Know that we're trying to do our best with this. Thank you.